everybody. So welcome to the 2014-2015 season of Hot Topics. Would you all believe it's the fifth season? So tonight's program, for those of you who were here last year, I don't want to overdo this, but we probably have one of the best speakers we've had for 5 years coming back. Captain and I were discussing whether or not to put you all under arrest. We decided we'll just talk to you. Put you at ease. Anyway, there are a number of things I wanted to talk about. The first thing I'm going to talk about is that Joy Rodenberg has nothing to talk about. I don't know how shocked you are, but I was still on the floor. Let me make sure I've got a couple of notes because I want to make sure we do this right. A request from Lorelei and Bob Ennis. There is an Israeli solidarity event at Temple Dor Dareem on the 14th of December. It's a Sunday. The ambassador for the United Nations is coming there. And if you're interested, just give me your email and I'll make sure Lorelei gets back to you. You've got to be there, I think, an hour beforehand because they've got to screen you for security. But I mean, this promises to be a really interesting thing. Apparently, no holds barred. You can ask this guy anything. He's got a lot to say about the situation around the world. You can email in the questions to Lorelei, I believe.
What day is it?
That's the 14th of this. I'll send you.
Yeah.
But that will start there.
I think you've got to be there by 3:30.
Yes. Is there a charge for this or no?
There's no charge. It's free. There's no charge, as far as I know. And I believe they have dessert, cookies, and stuff like that.
Charging for that? No.
Where's the alarm? You want to announce my class, or should I announce my class? I teach the iPad, iPhone to people like us on a once-a-month basis. It's a two-hour class, and it's going to be held next Wednesday at 5 o'clock at the Broward County Library in Weston. For this, there's an enormous charge. It's $5. $5. $5. But it's a contribution to the Friends of the Library. It's from 5 to 7. Right now, we've typically had 20 people in the class. We go from the very basics of how do you turn it on or turn it off to how do you act to really advanced stuff like how do you manipulate your apps. So it's everything and anything. It's run as a workshop. And besides me, we probably have the three or four best instructors in the world. Yes. Or my grandchildren. who really know what it's about. Eli, you want people to sign up with you tonight?
Yes. If you're interested, please give me your name and I'll put you down on our list.
There's a practical limit. I mean, we've had 50 people, 40 people, and it's crazy. So if we can get to 20, 25, that would be enough. The other thing that I'll tell you is be prepared if you come to the class for somebody to say that's not on my phone or that's not on my iPad. It just happens every single time. I don't have that. Okay. Out of courtesy to you. You should be sorry. Out of courtesy to the chief and his staff, I think it would be good if we either put our phones on stun or shut them off. The last thing before we get to
what is stun?
What?
What is stud?
Stud is when you put it on something. Last thing, just as a pre-announcement, and we'll go through this at the end of the meeting, our next meeting is going to be another very special meeting. We've got Marco Rubio, State Director of Political Affairs, going to come talk to us, both as a discussion and a Q&A. Now, I know some of the Democrats are going, but you know, you got to hear what the other people are thinking about. We've talked about this several times before. The other thing is we've been trying, in all fairness, and I really want to thank Jim Jones. I'll thank him again for his efforts. He's trying to get Debbie Wasserman Schultz and company to come. And apparently, they're just not that interested in Weston. Just saying. I'm sorry. We'll get it. Jim? I'd like you to talk to Jim and work with him. Okay, now let's, and we'll talk about what the next five or six hot topics will be like at the end of the meeting, so I'd appreciate it if you would stay through. But more importantly, we have the man, the myth, the legend, and two people with him. Many of you know Captain or Chief Kevin Butler, who is not only a tremendous executive police officer, but just a great human being as well. I know if you, has everyone gotten an email from me? Is anyone who didn't get an email who has an email address? Good. So then you know his background. It's just terrific. He runs a great shop. For those of you on Facebook, you may have seen my posting that Weston is one of the maybe the safest city in Florida. So, save me, thank you. The mother of Weston has spoken. And without further ado, I really appreciate, and I think you'll love to hear what Captain Butler has to say. He runs a terrific shop. He's got 104, more or less.
Actually, about 107.
107. People working for him, so he's a very senior executive in the BSO, and got a lot of good things to say.
Great. Thank you. Nice introduction. A couple things. I know there's a Dolphin game on tonight, so I'm going to try to move kind of quickly. If there's something you, well, maybe we'll catch the second half. I'd like everybody to see some of the graphs that I'm going to be putting up, and so we're probably getting our slides. We're going to probably shut the lights off. That's all right with everybody. And can everybody hear me? Because I like to move around a little bit, and that'll give me a little freedom. So I'll hit both sides of the room. If someone feels they need a question answered right away, I'd be happy to do that and address that. I wanted to introduce, everybody probably knows Carrie Pilato. She's been with the City of Weston. 12 years. She pretty much one of the first people when I got here kind of gave me the ropes of Weston because I really didn't know much about it. I did know about it, but I didn't know much about the city itself. And Lieutenant DeMarco's here. He's my alpha or night shift lieutenant. He lives in the city, so everything I have to say is very important to him. Last year we had some inclement weather. We had a lot of rain, so we had a decent turnout. I was very surprised, but night went pretty quickly, so hopefully we'll do the same. I'm going to talk about your city, your town. You know, when I look around, I see the same residents at different meetings, different functions, different events. You are the people that make this city work. I mean, we have the city commission, but the social aspect, you guys are the driving force for the city commission, the mayor, the city manager. They listen to you, and so you guys are very important. You're very important to me. You're my customers. And it's a great opportunity for me to tell you what's going on in your city, good, bad, or indifferent. I'd like to tell you, we are the safest city in the state of Florida, and a news agency from Jacksonville rated us number one for a city our size, which was really wonderful, because we're a very diverse community. That's all belongs to you guys. Now, I'm going to talk about Bonaventure. I'm going to talk about the city and Bonaventure. I think a lot of people come from the Bonaventure area, so if that's all right, I will be going to the Bonaventure. I'll talk about different calls for service that we handle here. Talk about a couple crime incidents we had up here in Bonaventure and around the city, how it may impact you, how it may not impact you. But we'll get started. Everybody's good? All right, keep your hands to yourself.
I'd like to see it even
down a lot further, but believe it or not, over the last 2 years, we're down 50% residential burglaries. So that's a really good number. Last year, we got our residence burglaries down, and I'm going to talk a little bit about what's happening in Bonaventure with break-ins. But thefts was a problem. It's been a problem for a couple of years. It's been stagnant. We tried a couple of things. We tried to get the number of thefts down. Anybody have an idea? What's the most common thing stolen in Weston?
Cell
phones. Number one. Does anybody know what the second most item that's stolen?
TVs.
Not TVs and not bicycles. Bicycles is a good guess. Decals. Decals on your car, your tag. And you know where they're doing that? They're doing it in Bonaventure. I don't know why, but somebody up here steals decals. We did make an arrest on a stolen decal, but you wouldn't confess to any others. They just pull it right off. It's you know, if you do it gingerly, you can get it off.
What if they exit? In other words, so they can't pull it off.
Well, then it comes off in pieces.
Yeah.
But you're right. You can do that.
Are they stolen in shopping centers or people's homes?
Parking lots. Yeah, they're coming out of parking lots overnight. I'll talk a little more about that, but that's pretty much a two-year comparison. That's January to October, the end of October of this year, as opposed to last year. All right, this is something that we probably do on a weekly, every week to 2 weeks. If you see the bottom columns, that's last year, and well, you really can't see the color. The colors are really bad, I'm sorry. But the column on the right, on the bottom, the one on the left is 2013, the one on the right is 2014. And what I'm talking about, we had 39, you could barely see it, but the first column here, it says January, we had 39 reported crimes this year, this January. Last year, we had 47. Over here, October, we had 28 crimes. And when I say crimes, the UCR crimes, up above, case reported, auto thefts, burglary business, you know what I have? Right here, auto theft, burglary business. These are UCR crimes. This is what the FBI, this is what they record around the country. So these are our UCR crimes that really, this is our report card for the police department. So the total number is this, like 39. We had 39 of these crimes occur in the month of January. As you can see, 2013, 2014. Right now, I think we're at 26% down in crime. Last year we had 462. This year we're at 343. I think last year, nationally, the whole country, we were ranked 43rd in the whole country for lowest crime rate. So it was, I think this year we're going to be up there. John Flynn said that he won't be happy until we're number one. So I may have to stick around about another 10 years.
Who is number one now?
I don't know. I don't care. No, I'm kidding. I really don't know. That's a good question, though. But, you know, this is a population of over, and they graded on a population over 25,000. Because you get small communities, 5,000, they have no crime. We're 66,000, so we're a decent sized municipality. All right.
What was UCR again?
UCR is Uniform Crime Report. It's all the property crimes, murder, burglary, theft, ag assault. It's the crimes that we have to report to the federal government. And they track them nationally. Every municipality, every township, every state has to report it. It's the law. You really can't see this, but I like to call this the gold standard. The reason I say that right here is 2014. We're at 343, 26% decrease from 2013 to 2014. That's last year, the year before. 2010, we're at 681. So we are almost 50% in 5 years. So these are the decreases for each year. 1, 14, 21, 26. So, you know, it's the economy. I will tell you, there's law enforcement, the economy, the market of people working, people, you know, property sales, is there a job market out there? It really, there are so many factors. I'd love to tell you, listen, it's the police chief. I came in 2011. However, you had a good police chief before I got here, and it continues. I mean, listen, one of our things that we do is we leave tomorrow is continuity. The person that jumps in my seat will give you the same service I'm giving you, the same service that Greg Page gave, and before, actually, Greg was the first chief out here. So, for the most part, you know, Weston has always been in good shape as far as crime. However, you know, it's a target-rich environment. And unfortunately, we are surrounded by two highways that it makes it sometimes challenging for us to do or catch these burglars. So I'll move on. But that I'd like to see that. It's a nice, there we go. The color is bad here. I apologize, but this kind of gives you where our crimes are. Auto thefts, you really can't. It's spread out all over. It's not one location. Robbery, you know, five robberies. It's not a lot, but you know, when I look at the robberies, it's a kid listening to music. Another kid came by on a skateboard, grabbed his headphones, took off. That was a robbery. He you know, by force, he took profit. So a couple of these robberies, I mean, they're not like we're from the generation, you know, somebody got held up at gunpoint. It's different. This is, could be anything taken by force, like a book bag, a radio, we had a cell phone. A kid was selling a cell phone on the internet. He was meeting a guy at, what was it, Craigslist. This is over the summer. And the kid came, he had no intention of buying it. He said, let me look at the phone. Boom, he took off. He snatched it out of his hands. It was a robbery, sudden snatching. So, five robberies is very low for a community of 66,000 people.
On that,
sure.
Is there any correlation between communities that have a gate?
You know, I'll talk about that. You know, when I first got here to Weston, I came from a kind of different community. I came from Central Broward. And we didn't have any gated communities except for the jail. That was the only gate. But here we do have 65% of Weston is gated. Maybe even a little higher, maybe 68%. And I will tell you, there is less crime in gated communities. Not significantly great number, but there is. It does prevent some people from coming into the community. However, we've worked burglaries from, you know, people that came up from Miami, they were getting into Savannah, they were following cars in, they knew how to get in, they were parking on the side of the road, going over into the, over the berms, getting into the neighborhood. So it was still happening, but the frequency was less than a non-gated community. Fortunately, Bonaventure is a non-gated community, so you're kind of target-rich for people that come out here. And I will tell you, there is a group out of Central Broward. They come out to Weston. They don't really know how to get around here. They use GPSs. You know, honest to God, when we catch them, we like to look at their GPS. It tells us where they've been. They got all our parks marked on a GPS. So they go to the parks, they break in the cars, and stuff like that. We caught someone last year, and he had every park in Weston in it. He didn't know where he was going. However, he knew where all the places were where he can snatch purses and things like that. So Bonaventure, yeah, it's not gated, and we do have, they do come down off of 84 and also from Weston Road. We followed some burglars one day in unmarked cars. These guys didn't know it, but there were like five unmarked cars just, you know, just following all over the place, and they just thought it was traffic all around them, you know. So finally, we watched them do a burglary in Davie. We're not into chasing cars anymore. It's too dangerous, so we rear-ended the car and disabled it. So that was, late last year. So let me move on. There we go. Can I go back? Yeah, I did go back. All right. Boy, that color is terrible.
Yeah. It'd
be great if you're Halloween. Auto thefts. As you can see, it really hasn't changed. 27 in 2010, have 16 now. Yeah, it definitely has decreased. Loan to an acquaintance, you know, 1 out of 15. Most of the auto thefts we do recover. The zone, 802 zone had 6 cars taken down here. 802 is Bonaventure. So you can see, not the highest number of vehicles taken, but the second highest. 808 is our Weston Road corridor. This is where most of our crime is, where all the commercial businesses are. That is our primary for accidents, thefts, and car burglaries. I looked at 802, I looked at the auto thefts, and frankly, there were a couple motorcycles, 3 motorcycles, and 3 old cars. One of them was like a girl who was staying with the guy, and she took the car. So, you know, nothing that you should be concerned about, that somebody's lurking around. Listen, no one's looking to steal your car. They're looking to get in your car, take your valuables, especially your identification. That's where people make money. And I'll tell you a little bit real quick about that. I worked in Strategic Investigations Division for about 8 years. We targeted major traffickers, narcotic traffickers, you know, international. And a lot of them, you know, we sent them to prison. When they came out, you know, they didn't go back into the drug business. They went back into the fraud business. They made more money, it was safer, and if you get arrested, you get, you know, you get a year, 2 years, and you're back out. So we're seeing a lot of these drug traffickers now are getting involved in doing scams. And we're going to show a couple of people that we arrested in Weston, just to give you some insight what's occurring in the city. Commercial, nine of the vehicles was taken from commercial property, 7 from residential. All right, burglary conveyance. This was a real problem for us, especially when I got here. My first month here was June. And I got to tell you, we had over 100 crimes that month. And I was like, what is going on? Every day we were having burglaries, people breaking into cars, breaking into homes. We made about 7-8 arrests. From that point on, it started to go down. So thank God, because I wouldn't be here. Renee would have me thrown out in 3 months. Just kidding. But as you can see, our, you know, 6% decrease, 2010 to 2011, and then 2012. We're, the last 3 years were around 30% each year. So a nice decrease in car burglaries. We did have some, and I'll probably use the next slide down here. These are where the car burglaries are taking place. Commercial. You know, where would you break into a car commercial? Post office, you run in real quick. These guys sit in a car. They're just sitting here. They watch you pull up. They watch you go into the store, either a nursery or a school, a gym, especially gyms. And, you know, we haven't had too many in Publix. That's kind of unusual, but we haven't had too many in Publix. But gym, it just seems like nurseries, gyms, they really target the why. They had a real problem out there. But they would watch you go in, and as soon as you hit that door, they'd pop your window. Nobody would hear it. Very silently, pop it, go in, boom, grab it. If they were by themselves, which is unusual, they usually have a driver. The driver would be a blocker, so you wouldn't even see it happen if you were in the parking lot. So it was a real problem. It still is. We still have a problem. If I get to a car or burglary, and the windows pop, I know it's not a Weston person that broke into the car. I know they're from outside. They're what we call felony lane people. They're looking for your cash, sure, but they want your identification. They want your checkbooks. They want your credit cards. That's what they're looking for. And you know what? They don't give it up either. They hold on to that stuff for years. And all of a sudden, I don't know if it's happened to anybody, but we just had a case. 9/11, not a hard day to remember. A girl just got out of prison. She got out of prison. Boom, she's in a stolen car. She's got wigs in the car. She's got a bunch of stolen identification. She was from the West Coast. I think she was a prostitute at one time or another. And she had a blonde wig on. She had somebody's stolen ID. She was trying to cash a check that was stolen from Fort Myers, like 14 months earlier. So they don't get this stuff up. They hold on to it. So get back to car burglaries. We did have a problem up here in Bonaventure. We were there was a crew of kids that were targeting us. And I'm going to show you their pictures. They're going to look a little orange, but they're young kids, and they were out here at night, 2 o'clock in the morning when we were all sleeping, going through our cars. And quite a bit. They hit Bonaventure, they hit Plantation, they hit Sunrise. Now, these kids are on foot. Well, I think most of them had skateboards, but there were 4. One thing we encountered with this group when we arrested them, they broke in. They didn't break in. They went in. Their cars were locked. Those are the only cars they were going into. But we had 2 cars in Bonaventure that they went into and they got guns at them. Unlocked cars with guns in them. That, to me, is in this day and age, that should be a crime almost. But it isn't. But we're really concerned about that. Let me go to the slide. I'll show you these young lads that weren't getting ready for school. Here they are. I mean, this kid, look how young he is. Hundreds of cars these guys broke into. All over Davy, Weston, Sunrise. We finally caught him, and we had a burglary. Somebody saw him looking in the cars, and we ended up catching all 4 of them. He's the oldest. These guys are juveniles, by the way, and why I could show you the picture, we're allowed, if we arrest somebody for a felony, a juvenile, we're allowed to show his picture. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to show his picture. This was the only adult. I mentioned before, they got 2 guns one night. They did get a gun out of a Navy burglary, too, a car burglary. So that was really concerning to me, and we called David, and these kids are all from Navy, by the way. And we called David, we spoke to the detective out there, we said, hey, these kids sold the 2 guns to this kid so-and-so. We ended up being he was a gang member, some gang in Haiti. And the detective said, listen, he's not going to give you those guns back. They're gone. You're never going to see him again. And I was like, well, we're going to try to get those guns back. So we paid this little gangbanger a visit. We sent 4 or 5 of our biggest deputies to his house. And we said, we're going to make your life miserable until we get those guns back. And the next day we got both guns back, so I was really happy about that.
What happens to them after you arrest them?
Well, that's another big question. Well, a couple of these kids they're probably all in programs. There's probably no one right now that's in jail. They're probably all out. They're all school-age kids, 2:30 in the morning. I don't know, if my kid's going out the door and he's 15 years old and midnight, there's going to be a struggle at the front door, either him coming or going.
Did they just want to be mischievous, or was it for
no? They were just stealing people's property. They were stealing sunglasses, cash. It got to a point they were being selective on what they were taking. Laptops. They weren't really even taking sunglasses anymore. They weren't even taking GPSs because they had plenty of them. So they've taken things, and people leave their wallets in the car. I got to tell you, I'm always shocked by that.
But these guys are in business.
No, these are teenage kids. Look at their ages, 1 to 97. They were a crew stealing together. Yeah, and on skateboards, riding through. And, when they see the headlights coming, and they'd all hide. And then as soon as the car went by, they were back out looking. Somebody spotted them from a balcony, and that's pretty much how we ended up catching them. But we weren't doing surveillance. We had, I will tell you, we have our deputies at night. We put them out on bicycles. If we have a problem in the area, we don't want a car, checking the area. We want a nice, quiet bicycle, a deputy on a bicycle. So, we had some problems with graffiti in the city, which is a real serious, it could be a real serious problem if you go to other parts of the county. We take it real serious here, and I'll tell you why. And this is what I tell my deputies. You're coming to Weston, you want to buy a house. You drive down the road and you see graffiti. What are you thinking? You're thinking crime, gangs, whatever. You're thinking about it. You may not verbalize it, but it's in the back of your head. You may say, I'm going to go up to Parkland, take a look, see what that looks like. So that's why for us, it's real serious. Number one, we simply spot graffiti, get it painted within an hour, 2 hours. And we assign people, we have a CST team, and what they do, we put them out there at night, they do surveillance, they ride bicycles, they start questioning kids. We go on Facebook, social media. We go on social media, because these guys love to brag and love to take pictures of what they do. And I'm going to show you somebody who did that. We're able to catch it. I'm getting ahead of myself here. Sorry about that. Burglary residence. This, to me, is the ultimate crime. I've been a victim of a burglary residence. And I'll tell you, if it happens to you, you really do feel violated and never fully feel safe at home. I will tell you, this past Friday, me and my wife, had the day off, drove up to Ormond Beach. It was 11 o'clock in the morning. At 11:28, three guys in a rental car pulled up to my neighbor's house across the street. They broke into both houses. So I have the home cameras, so I got it all on video. So I'll meet with Davey tomorrow and give him a copy of the video. Unfortunately, they were too far away, I couldn't see their tag number, but residential burglary is a real serious problem in Broward County. The sheriff recognized that, and what he did was he put a team together. It's called BAT. It's a burglary apprehension team. A lot of the commands have given personnel for this team, and all they do is track down burglaries. And I'll tell you, this works. Burglaries have been reduced across the board in Broward County. Tampa had a really bad problem with residential burglars. And what they did was they developed a hot sheet, which we do, by the way. We have a hot sheet. And let me tell you, it really works. Our kids, you know, has anybody ever heard this? 20% of the population commits, you know, 80% of the crime. It's true. I mean, it's variations, 15%, but it really is true. If you target that 20%, and anytime they step, you know, they commit some minor offense, lock them up, charge them. They get no breaks. You target them, your crime will drop. Well, Tampa did that. They reduced burglaries by 50% in a 2-year period. They had quite a few. So it does work. It worked here in Weston. We have a hot sheet. We update it. The guys that we have arrested for some of our serious crimes, burglaries, graffiti, they're on our hot sheet. Every one of them. Two of our worst graffiti guys in the past year were both on a hot sheet. We knew who they were before they were even committing these crimes, because they were involved in narcotics, they were involved in a lot of different things. So we weren't sitting out in front of their house, but if we heard something, so-and-so is involved in this, we looked into it. So we do target, and they're juveniles and adults, it makes no difference. That may be one other reason why crime has been reduced in the city of Weston. But if you can see, it's kind of a shotgun effect. Up on the, if you can see the map, and I don't want to get in anybody's way, that square box up there, that's Bonaventure. You can see more incidents up there than the rest of the city. They're a little more spread out. Bonaventure is a target, I will tell you that. They like to come to Bonaventure because the highway's there, and they also come up from 75. It's a quick in and quick out, and it's definitely an issue. We just finished a 4-week traffic operation. So I like to do traffic operations because we sometimes encounter these guys driving around in a neighborhood. So a lot of our traffic stops ends up in arrest. And you'll see that our citations have increased, not because we want to, you know, generate income or anything like that, but we do traffic for two reasons. We try to reduce accidents and also try to catch criminals that are driving around the neighborhood. Because a lot of those guys, they don't pay attention to laws. You know, they're blowing stop signs, speeding, and they don't know where they are half the time anyway. So traffic is very important to catching these burglars that are hitting our areas. But Yeah, we do, you can see there's a clump right here, that's Bonaventure. So our last couple of operations have been up here, but it's really slowed down. Beginning of the year, I was a little concerned, our burglaries got up, but we were able to reduce that. We put our motormen up here, we put deputies up there on bicycles, and eventually it really slowed down. Also, that fat team I talked to you about, our burglars, a lot of them don't come from Weston. The gated communities, the kids that live in those gated communities are usually the ones that are doing the burglaries in the gated communities. So they have their issue. Like, I mean, Savannah, we had a real notorious burglar in there. 24 burglaries. We had a hell of a time catching them. We finally did. I think I may have mentioned it. It was last summer. We shut the power off. He was a really smart guy. He'd walk around at night. He knew who was away and who wasn't. He'd target the house. He'd shut the power off, deactivate the alarm, the battery would go dead. Then he'd go in there and have a field day. So we eventually caught him, and he went to prison. So that was a good thing for him. Right here, as you can see, remember I said, what was it, 2012? We had a jump. We were 111 residential burglaries. Real concerning. Look where we are right now, 45. I'd like to see zero. That'd be a perfect world, but 45 is pretty good in a city of 66,000 residents. So, you know, what we see is smashed door. It's usually the back door. They come around the back, smash the, if you have an alarm system, most of you do, I think Bonaventure built out here, everybody got an alarm system, you may still be using it, maybe not. But they're contact alarms, they're not glass breakage. These guys know you have old alarm systems, so they smash the glass, they never open the door, and they never set off the alarm. Now, when they break the glass, they're not making a lot of noise. They just pop it. They have center punches, and it's just real quiet. It's not a big sound, you know. It's like, not like shh. So that's pretty much the method they get in. You know, obviously, this was a problem. Last year was the garage, open garages. We're down to two. Last year we had about 11. And it was really driving us nuts. And I had my deputies at night drive around the neighborhood and knock on people's door at 1 and 2 o'clock in the morning and say, your garage is open. So listen, I would want to know my garage is open because, you know, you don't want somebody wandering in while you're there, you know, sleeping. So I kind of, you know, seen a reduction here. Workers in the residence, I don't know how that works, but maybe they think people come back that worked on a property. You know, cutting the screen. You know, we had in Bonaventure, we had a bunch of screens cut and property taken right from the patio. It never went in the house. That's a residential burglary. We take that as a burglary. So we had several of those. All right, yeah, there we are, 45. In 2014, you know, up. I'm satisfied, but, you know, I could be a lot happier. This is thefts. And I remember I told you in 2012, we were really talking about, by the way, Carrie, I don't know if she loaded all the pictures, but that's all right. Thefts. This is 2012, we were looking at the end of the year. We said, you know, for the last 4 years, our thefts have been high, you know, 268, 291, just been pretty high. Let's really concentrate on getting this number down. Here, 2014, it's down to 176. You know, what are we doing different? We're doing things differently in the park. The why? We're losing stuff out of the why. People are leaving their cell phones on the counter. So we're talking to them. They were leaving their car keys on a board where people could pick up the keys. Go out and get in the car. We still have a problem with kids playing basketball. They leave their cell phone on the floor. When they take those cell phones, they're over $300. It's a grand theft. So it's really, really, really taking a beating here. So we've made some changes. Went out. Carrie did some community policing stuff, crime prevention stuff. And I'd like to think we really reduced that number. But that was one of our goals: reduce petty thefts and grand thefts. Remember what I said? Number one item taken, cell phones. Next one, auto tags, decals, currency. That's, you know, people coming over to your house stealing cash. We still once in a while get Publix where we caught a lady last year. You guys may have seen it on TV. She'd been arrested like 3 times doing it. She was out on probation. We caught her on video. We put it out in the media. We had her in custody the next day. But she would follow people around in Publix and take their wallets out. So she actually went to prison because she was on probation. But these are typical things that they take. I mean, holiday decorations, guitar, really odd stuff. Bluetooth, I don't know what that could be. Appliances usually from abandoned houses. Backflow valve. 5 backflow valves. You know what those are? They put them on all commercial property. They're made of brass. They're very, they're for scrap metal. You get a lot of money for them. Well, they were ripping these off of buildings, and we were getting a flood of water. They were flooding out the area of the parking lots. I think all 5 of those came from the town center. So the city, in order to combat this, it's a real big problem east of us. What the city did, they passed an ordinance where they have to have this security device put around the backflow, and we haven't had one since taken. So that really worked out. All right, these are the our zones, and 802, like I said, is Bonaventure, 14%. The thefts occurred in Bonaventure, 25. So, you're not the highest, but you're third or fourth lowest, or from the top, 33. Remember I said Weston Road? That's what we call our 808 zone. That's that commercial corridor, the commerce center and stuff. That's where we have a lot of our thefts, right there, 33%. Type of property it's taken from, residential, commercial, schools, parks. You know, schools now have a program. It's called the Promise Program. If they catch a kid stealing, they used to call us. Last year, the year before they would call us, we'd come. We would, maybe put them in a diversion program. Well, now they do a diversion program right in school. And they put them on a program, they got to write essays, they got to do community service work. And they'll do this 2 or 3 times, and then if the kid continues, then they'll call us. So we'll probably see some reduction in thefts. Not a lot, because they didn't call us all the time on those, but we'll see some reduction this year, just from that alone. We're down 31% in thefts. So that, I'm happy to see that reduction next year. Hopefully we can do better. I wanted to show you guys this because this is a really important, it doesn't look important to you, but this is important for me. And, one of the conversations I have with the city, with John Flint and mayor and commissioners, how do we know we have enough police officers working on the road? Well, this pretty much will tell them if they have enough or not. And when you look at that, you say, well, how do you figure that out? This here is the times of the day, right here. This is the number of deputies working. 8 deputies, right here on the left. Calls for service. This is year to date. This is for the month of, actually for the whole year, January through October. Calls for service and response time, I'll talk about that in a minute. Now, at, let's see, this is, that's the whole year. This is weekends. Okay, this is weekends at 8 p.m. Oh, actually, right here, 12 a.m. 12 a.m. is the busiest time on weekends for calls for service. 5 or 6 deputies are on calls. That means there's only 2 deputies free to take additional calls. So at least five deputies are usually tied up at midnight on the weekend nights, and there's only 2 deputies left to respond to calls. That's actually not bad because that's, a high. To be honest with you, we were much higher than this. It's really come down. This is weekdays and five deputies in cover. Now, this doesn't account for a deputy on lunch or a deputy going to court or a deputy in training. But this tells you how many deputies are busy at any time during a day. So then we know what is a good number to have on the road. How many deputies should the city pay for? So this pretty much tells us. By the way, I give this the city this report every month. and we base it on calls for service. This stuff can get a little dry, so if you want to ask me a question, go right ahead. Average public response time. This is the time you call 911, the operator picks up, to the time the deputy gets out of his car at the scene. The average time was 8 minutes in 2014 in January. In 2013, it was 10 minutes and 32 seconds. So you would think, boy, they're getting there faster. It's kind of a problem, and I'd love to tell you, hey, we're really getting there faster. But what's happened is they're now counting traffic stops as a call. And when a deputy does a traffic stop, he sees the violation, I'm stopping the car. They assign the case number. What's the response time? Zero. It's zero. And they're averaging that into our calls that we're responding to. So it's really skewed our numbers. We're trying to break that out. Unfortunately, I'm giving you skewed numbers, and I want you to know that, just in case you want to prosecute me later on down in this video. No, seriously, we are working on that, but it kind of gives us an idea what our response time is. Year-to-date average here, for a deputy, once he gets the call, until he gets to your house, 6 minutes. It's probably more like 7.5 minutes. All right.
Mr. Butler?
Yes.
Out of your apartment, how many actual shifts do you have working on an 8-hour shift?
On an 8-hour shift, I have at least 8 deputies. I have at least 2 crime prevention detectives. I have a CST team that works midday, but we use them. If we have a problem at night, they're working nights. If it's in the morning, they're working in the morning. And that's 6-7 people. Then I have 7 motormen on top of that. So, motorcycles. They primarily work during the day. You're not gonna see a motorman at night in West unless he's working a detail. The reason being, listen, we have 9 schools, and every one of them are packed to the gills, and we assign them each school every morning, and that's what they're doing. The scariest thing for a chief in Weston is a kid getting hit by a car. And, so those guys, that's their job. That's their baby. They got to handle it. And I was talking to earlier from the library. We have issues there. Listen, you drive around at 7:30 in the morning in Weston, you're going to run into a traffic jam if you're near a school. We have too many kids. We have too many parents that drive their kids to school. And there's really nothing we can do about it. I've asked parents at PTA meetings, hey, why don't you put your kids on the bus? I'm not putting my kid on the bus. You see what happens on the bus? They see a video of some kid in Minnesota getting beat up, and they think it's occurring here. It probably is, but we don't know. I'm being facetious. That's not really true. Calls, year-to-date calls. These are the amount of calls we get a month. Right now, October, this past month, we had 2,469 calls that we responded to in the month of October. We never close. We're 24/7, so it's not a crazy number.
What are they mostly about? What are your top
calls? I'm gonna show you our top calls for service. Don't get it, Larry. I'm sorry. Show you this real quick, and then we'll move on, and we'll get to that call, what calls we go on. This is out of the, 11,000 calls that we've been on so far. 49% of those calls only require one deputy, right here. Just one deputy's going. On 44% of the calls, we have to send 2 deputies. That may be a domestic, it may be a fight in progress. So 44% of our calls, we have to send 2 deputies. On 3%, we're sending 3 deputies. On 2%, we're sending 4 deputies. That's a burglary in progress. We need perimeter deputies. That's maybe a pursuit, someone fleeing, a real serious crime, a guy with a gun. And listen, if there's a guy with a gun in Weston, you're going to get about 10 deputies coming. You're going to have detectives. You're going to have motormen. You're going to have the chief, the lieutenants, the sergeants were all coming.
I'll be there first.
All right. Who asked about calls? This is our number one call year to date in 802 zone, which is Bonaventure. Your community from January to September 2014. Number one call, police service calls. That could be anything from where do I pay my taxes to who's going to change my flat tire. This is really the main call. Alarm calls. 318 alarm calls. Let me tell you right now, they're probably all false. False alarm calls, it really takes a lot of our resources. And what we're doing now, last year we looked into, we really started to look at our false alarms. I have Lieutenant O'Brien, he looks at it every month, he gets with Kerry. We look at our frequent false alarm calls. You know, we have like a residence or a business, we'll have 7-8 false alarm calls in 1 month. We go pay them a visit, we call their alarm company. You know, they're in the city of Weston, you don't get charged for more than 2 alarms. You know, we're going to come 150 times if we have to. But now, if we're there more 4 or 5 times, we're going to work with you to get that problem fixed because we don't want to keep coming. You're going to get an unhappy deputy if you have more than 10 false alarms. Information calls, that could be anything medical. Those are usually related to fire. 911 hangups. You get a lot of people that call 911 and hang up. I'm going to call the cops on you. Pick up the phone, call 911. Ah, forget it. And we still have to send somebody. So, disturbance. This is, remember, this is Bonaventure. 55 disturbance domestic calls. This is the one I like. Suspicious person. 75. That's a good number. That means somebody that lives in Weston, in Bonaventure, sees somebody suspicious. They pick up the phone, they call us and say, I see a suspicious person. I like those calls. Those are good calls. I wish it was, you know, 318 as opposed to 75, but that's still a good number. You know, I told you earlier that my 2 neighbors got broken into. This morning, my neighbors were out. Hey, Kevin, they saw a car match the same description parked in the street, just standing in the street, same, because when I found out the color of the vehicle, I told all my neighbors, hey, it looks like a silver Jeep, it's tinted windows, hey, we saw it down here, we were watching. Did anybody call the police? No. I wanted to strangle them. They knew right away I wasn't happy. You know, you think it's, hey, it's suspicious, call us. You know, we don't charge for a call, we don't care. So,
a quick question.
Yes.
That's not a 911 call.
Sure is. That's a 911 call. You know what? Call 911 all the time. Somebody can sue me, but you know what? Call 911. If you see something that doesn't look right, call 911. We'll come, we'll say, you know what? There's nothing to that.
Better be safe than sorry.
Yeah, call 911. I've had people that tell me, you know, I called the non-emergency number, I waited 25 minutes. Never call non-emergency. I'm sorry. This is Weston. Call 911. Kerry told you so.
I don't know the numbers.
Hey, loose formatters. Who's got farm animals in Bonaventure? 13.
Hey, we have a question.
I have a question.
Oh, okay.
Several years ago, we had an incident on the tennis courts in Weston.
Yes.
And there was a discrepancy. If you call 911 from a cell phone versus a landline, can they track you?
Yes.
Which way is the better way to call it?
Cell phone's fine. Cell phone. Everybody's got cell phones. Don't go into the house to call a landline. Whatever you have in your hand, use that. Landline's fine, cell phone's fine. Because if you call 911 with your cell phone, as soon as we pick up the phone, we know your coordinates, we know where you're at.
Yeah, it's changed over the years. Yeah, years ago it wasn't so strong, but now with all the cell phone towers up and everything, it's a lot better.
Don't try to catch me.
But what is the
you know, you call and say, hey, there's a red motorcycle doing 150 miles an hour down Bonaventure. You know what? We're not going to chase him.
Okay.
We're not going to chase him because you know what? We're going to be screaming behind him. We're not going to catch him. we just can't catch motorcycles. He's going to either hit a tree, a wall, or another car, unfortunately. And if we're chasing him, everybody's going to sue us, and there's really nothing we can do. Listen, we can set up, try to block him, but we can't even do that. But call the reckless, because once he hits a car, we say, hey, we got a call. You're doing 150. We got a witness. So you drive a reckless. So it's good documentation.
If you're in a state with your cell phone and you have a 954 number,
yes,
and you dial 911, where does that ring?
If you are in Broward or Weston, you call 911 and it's a 954. You're probably going to get the dispatch at some.
No, that wasn't my question. If you're at a state,
with a
cell phone from
954, doesn't matter. They'll say this guy's calling from Connecticut. Unless you do it through the internet, we would have a problem tracking where it's coming from.
Right, but if you're in California,
it's the local California.
It goes to the 911 dispatch center closest to that cell tower.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, we're still going to get your location, but we'll know you're not calling from the area. But you know what? You know, our little geniuses today, and they really are truly geniuses, they build their own computers. They use the internet. You know, listen, you can go on Google and you can get your Google phone number and have a program to ring your phone. I think we're converting our building to voice over phone. It's all over the computer. So we're not going to have hard lines anymore. So all these kids, they do. We just had an incident at the high school. I don't think it was in the paper, but it's called swatting. Anybody ever see it on 2020 or 60 Minutes? It's becoming a real popular thing with these techie kids. What they do is they know you're at school. You're, say, at a high school, or you're at the house, and I'm in Maryland, you're in Broward County. They'll call the police, not emergency, because the line's not tracked, and they'll say, hey, Sam, who's wearing a white shirt, said he's going to kill all the kids in his class, goes to Cypress Bay, and, you know, he's carrying a gun in the bag, and he's going to kill people. We got a call like that, and he called non-emergency, and he hung up, and that's all we had. Well, we all responded, 15, 16 deputies to Cypress Bay High School. We shut down the cafeteria. They said he was in the cafeteria. Guess what? We get to the cafeteria, there's 500 kids in there. So, but we got a hold of him. We scared the crap out of the poor kid. And it turned out it was another kid who was in Maryland, a juvenile. And we are working to prosecute him. However, because he's a juvenile, it's interstate, the feds won't pick up the charges because they won't prosecute juveniles. All right, these are just the calls in alphabetical order. Accidents, that's a real problem. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But a lot of accidents in the city of Weston, I suspect that most of it is related to distraction driving. While you guys are all sitting here, phones going off, you're getting text messages, your grandkids are sending you messages. So we're constantly in communication with people while we're driving, when we should be paying attention. Our phone's ringing, so I think that has a lot to do. And that, I will tell you, we really tried to make an effort to reduce accidents, and it's really become a challenge. And I'm really not happy where we are right now. I'll show you a little bit of what's going on in the city with the accidents. Okay, anybody want to see any more of this? No. Arrest. You know, when I started in 1980, we didn't have computers, we had manual typewriters, but 1980, a good policeman, how many tickets he write, how many arrests he made, that's pretty much how we were judged. That's different now, it's much different. But I look at this, you know, where are we, we making more arrests, less arrests. I mean, our crime's down, it's 26% down right now. Last year was down 26%. We're 50% down in crime. So our arrests should be down, right? Well, our arrests aren't. They're up. Total right now, year to date, we're at 402 arrests. Right here, last year, this time, we're at 356 arrests. So we're making more arrests. 5 minutes ago. Who's paying attention?
Who?
Remember when I said traffic stops? When we make traffic stops, we check it for warrants, we see if you got pot in the car, if you got drugs, stolen property, guns, weapons. That's why I arrest them. Because I'm after the guys, not me, my command. Hey, let's do more traffic here, we're having problems. We do more traffic, and guess what? We end up with more arrests. That's why we're at 402. Really, we should be around 300 based on our crime. Juvenile civil citations. Anybody ever hear of that? What that is, it's been around about 10 years in Broward County, but Sheriff Israel, when he took office, he made a promise, he made it very clear to all the commands. He said, listen, I don't want to lock kids up and ruin their whole future because of one arrest, one simple mistake, one, hey listen, none of us here are perfect, except maybe Carrier. But seriously, we all make mistakes, and he doesn't want to ruin kids' careers, futures, I should say. So this is a diversion program, and what we're doing when we arrest kids for minor offenses, we put them in a diversion program. If they're good for 6 months, everything's dropped. Well, and these are the kids that, guess what? They've been arrested before. They don't get a break. They don't get a diversion program. I think it's a wonderful program. And I'll tell you the truth, I'm really happy the sheriff instituted it. Go ahead.
In this diversion program, how many graduate from it?
Do you know we have a high success?
And then go back to doing something.
About 20%. 15 to 20% go back and commit crime. So it's actually a pretty good number. It's a great program, and the sheriff really pushed it. And you know what? I think it's a wonderful idea. So. These are the arrest breakdown. You know, when do you think people get arrested most during the year? Don't say St. Patrick's Day. I know somebody said St. Patrick's Day.
Around Christmas time?
73, April. Holy April.
What's going on in April? And Easter,
taxes. Taxes is right. Thank you. This is something that we talked about before, and Baker Act. Does anybody know what, you know, pretty much everybody has an idea what Baker Act is.
Yeah.
It's if you're voluntarily committed to a hospital because you're a danger to yourself or to others, for the most part. It's the power that the state gives police officers to make a decision, this person's a danger to himself or others, and I gotta commit him, I gotta take him off the street right now. I don't know why, but last year we had 40, this year we're at 73. We've committed 73 people. That's temporary, it's like 48 hours and they're back out. That is a high number, that is a real high number. That's 73 or a majority of people that wanna hurt themselves. I'm gonna hurt myself, I'm gonna kill myself. We've had a couple suicides here. It's actually kind of interesting. We had two attempts, and then one eventually killed himself. He was a gentleman from China. He immigrated here, and he was unhappy. He wanted to go back, and I think his family was making a go of living in the United States, and he was very depressed. He eventually killed himself. Fortunately, his 12-year-old son found him. And then we had a 14-year-old girl from China living here, and she, same thing, just couldn't cope with the society, and she tried pills and stuff. And the reason I bring that up, those are two people that live in Bonaventure. So,
are any of your deputies trained to handle mental health issues?
Yeah, boy, who are you? Does he work for us? That's a great question. Another thing that Sheriff Israel is doing that is a great program, it's called CIT. And actually, one of the few CIT lieutenants in the agency is right here, Lieutenant DeMarco. Why don't you tell him a little bit about CIT?
CIT is the...
Can you put the lights on?
Yeah, absolutely. Everybody close your eyes. Be bright. CIT is our crisis intervention team, and we receive 40 hours of training to deal with mental illness, homeless issues, treating and learning how to deal with, they call them clients. When we go to a scene, learning to recognize the signs of someone who's going through a crisis. Quite oftentimes, it may be someone we're talking to and there may be some key words that they say, that they're seeing a psychologist, or that they're depressed, or you can tell by their moods. Is this one working? Can you hear me now? How about now? Just kidding. Our crisis intervention team. You'll see our deputies that are in our crisis intervention team. We wear the pin, the CIT pin. And clients that are regular clients in the mental health field who regularly see a psychologist or have alcoholism in their family, or they're dealing with drug addiction, if they're seeing a psychologist or if they're at part of the Henderson Mental Health Clinic, they will tell their clients, if you see a deputy with this crisis intervention team pin on, or an officer that comes to your house, know that they are trained specially to deal with the issues that you have and know where you can get help. And quite oftentimes I'll show up on a scene and a person will come right over to me and bypass the other deputies that are there because they see that. And when they do that, it kind of sparks something in my head to say, well, they must know, so they must deal, so they must have an issue. And we're able to deal with them. I'll tell you a very poignant story. One of our nighttime sergeants, Sergeant Tienga, was at the office one night, and a lady was knocking on the front door of the police station. This was a couple of months ago. And it was about 9 o'clock at night. And he went to the door, he opened the door, and met her. And she says, I saw on the internet that you guys have a crisis intervention and a suicide prevention class that meets here on Monday night. Okay, come on in. But it was an old posting that was very old, and it actually listed the old police station address when they were in the trailer. It was something that old that she had found, but she was going through a crisis. Now, most deputies who might not have been trained in that would have said, no, sorry, it's not here. Go ahead and have a good day. But he brought her in. He sat her down. He contacted some of the 211. Everybody knows what 911 is, but do you know what 211 is? 211 is Broward County's first call for help. And you can call that number and get the answers to just about everything. It's like going on the internet, and they have. So he sat her down, got her 211 for help, and actually had a Henderson Mental Health Clinic had an on-call doctor that night, and actually followed her over to meet with that doctor. And she was depressed. She was here from another country. She was here by herself. She was going through some issues at home as well. And she confided in the sergeant that if he had not helped her, she might have committed suicide that night. And like I said, that's something that I actually told that story in the last CIT graduation, because it reinforces the need for us to look for those cues and see those signs, and that some deputies might not pick up on that like the sergeant did. So yes, we have in the city right now, on each shift, we have at least two on each squad. We have two of our sergeants that have gone through the class, and we have four more deputies that between now and the end of the year, and I know the end of the year is close, there's a class for between Thanksgiving and the holidays that they'll be in there. So we have about, I want to say about 10 to 15 of our deputies here in Weston, which is a very good majority. So the chances of that. And we deal with everything from, like I said, child mental health issues to adults. We're going to get help for elderly individuals who may be going through some crisis, because mental health does not discriminate race, age, sex, whatever it is, it runs the gamut. So it is a very important program, and whoever asked that question, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to explain.
Well, one other point. You folks deal with Judge Ginger Lerner Wren?
Judge Wren, yes. She's very involved in the crisis intervention program. She actually does some of the family court, too.
First mental health court in the United States.
Yes. She's actually, when we do the CIT class, she's actually one of the guest speakers that comes and does like a two-hour block on the mental health court. Yep. Thank you. Lights.
Please.
I get to go back to...
on the other side of suicide, suicide calls, involved in. 30, last year was at 32, so a little decrease, pretty much stayed the same, but that's a concerning number right there. Frauds. We talked a little bit about it, touched on it. Frauds, big problem in South Florida. You are in scam capital, USA, the whole country. More frauds occur in Broward, Dade, and Palm Beach than probably anywhere in the country. Probably once a week I get a call from like California, hey, you got a guy in Weston who did a lottery scam, some lady in California. This I'm recalling this because I just got this notification. Guy called her, it came back to a Weston phone number. Basically, hey, you won a $3 million lottery, you just got to pay the taxes, $68,000. She sent the check, and you're not going to believe this, but it was just a scam number. The guy wasn't here, but probably somewhere in Broward County. Year-to-date, 2013, we had 258, we're at 255. Does anybody remember last year we talked about this? What kind of scams were taking place? Really a big scam that was occurring?
IRS fraud.
Yeah, you did. You called me one.
Yeah, I called you one time. Somebody called. I'm calling from the IRS. We have your number. We have your address. And we know what we're going to do.
Yeah.
And I immediately, I said, yes, give me a telephone. And you picked it up.
Yeah.
There was a telephone in Washington, D.C., exchange. And you called them. And you said it's probably from another country.
Yeah, it was from India, actually. Yeah. You get a lot of, you got a problem on your computer, that's really becoming rampant, but last year, tax returns.
Yes.
Tax returns was a real problem last year, we talked about that. This year, it's, workman's comp. They're basically filing false workman comp claims using your identity, and they're getting checks, and before the government finds out, they're long gone. So, quite a few in Weston, a lot of workman's comp scams.
They can't adapt to signs of the whole workman's comp. How can they make
it?
They forge.
I think I said this last year. If you go to the doctor's office, don't give them your social security number. You know why? They won't even ask for it. They give you a form, don't put it on there. I put little or no information on my doctor's form. You know what? No one's really paying attention anyway.
They want your license, they want your social security.
Sure, I don't give it to them. And you know what? They never ask me. They really don't. They don't ask, hey, you know, what's your social security number? No one's ever sent that to me. And you have people that work, you look at the people that work in doctor's offices, nothing against people. Listen, I'm not saying anything bad. It's just they're some of the young kids and they're minimum wage. And all they have to do is grab 100 files and they can make $1,000. So, you know, that's what's happening.
You're on Medicare.
Yeah, what about Medicare? That's your
number. If you have to, you know, if they have it, that's the risk, though. When you go to, like, medical offices, they're the worst for losing information. For employees to get your information.
What about visiting hospitals? They now ask for your driver's license.
Yeah, I'm not crazy about that. Well, if you come to Weston and want to visit somebody, you got to show your license at some of the security gates. I'm not really a fan of that.
They scan it in.
Yeah.
They don't even just show it.
I know there was an incident in Broward County Memorial Hospital where someone got a database of driver's license information. So, and now that was about 5 years ago. But frauds and scams, it's a real issue. We arrested, I think I told you, the girl that just got out of prison. There's a group that we just arrested last month. Are they on? Okay, I'll show you. I put this in there. This was actually November 2013. This is something we actually found. It's at a bank in Weston.
Oh, yes.
It's a skimmer. And right here, you guys really can't see it, but that's where you stick the credit card in. This was a fake ring. It was identical. And what it would do is read your ATM card. And right down here, at the bottom of the lip, there was a pinhole camera. So So when you go there, you put your card in, it's recording your number, and it's watching you put your code in. I will tell you this, when I go to an ATM machine, I do it all the time now. I put my hand over it, and I do my code. It looks silly, I'm sure people say, what's the matter with that guy? But I do that all the time now. I mean, if you try the devices, if they come off, obviously. We've caught two in the past year in Weston skimming ATM cards. One at Publix and one at the bank.
With your hand over what?
You know, like you put your card in and then you got to put your password, your code. I put it over my fingers because the camera is shooting down on the top of my hand. If I'm like this, they can see the numbers I'm hitting. They're recording it. If I go like this, they can't record it. We just had an incident, and I'm going to talk about it right now. Our sergeant caught these three people about 3 weeks ago. Two of them aren't even citizens. They're here from other countries. None of them are from Broward County. A sergeant decided to park in the back parking lot of a Publix, just taking a break. He's our CST guy. Remember I talked about CST, Community Strategy Scheme? They pretty much, if we have a problem, they go out and they address it, be it graffiti, burglaries, whatever. He's sitting there, and he watches this gentleman go up to, now they park all the way in the back parking lot, all the way in the back. You know, everybody likes to get up front. These guys are all the way in the back. So he watched them park actually close to him. He gets out of the car. He goes up to the ATM. He's there for like 5 minutes. There's a line behind him. He's like, it's kind of, he can see it, you know. He's noticing it. He gets back into the car. She goes up. Same thing. She's at the ATM. A line's behind her. What the hell are they doing? Then she comes back to the car. Then he goes up. They got hats on and sunglasses. Well, basically, he watched this, he knows something's up with this. He follows them to another parking lot, another Publix. They're doing the same thing, park all the way in the back, so the camera can't see their car or record their car. They have hundreds of false credit cards with stolen bank account numbers. They had $20,000 in cash. They had hundreds of stolen IDs. They said they were working with some organized guy and they were getting paid to do it, but I don't believe it was baloney. They were part of a larger group. This is the second group we caught in Weston doing this. But stealing people, they had blank cards just with an account number. And they were getting in and accounts, they had people's passcodes and everything else. So this was 3 weeks ago in Weston. This was...
Publix.
Yeah, it was Publix. It was Publix. It was two Publix.
How do these criminals get into our country?
Usually flying. No, you know, they get in on pieces. Pretty sharp. No, they get in on pieces and they stay. They're still in custody. Disturbance calls, somebody our last year we were talking about disturbance calls, so I threw this in, you know, quite a bit. What kind of disturbance calls are we responding to? 484 all different types, obviously. Noise, that's a big one. Juveniles, we get a lot of juveniles with disturbance calls up here. And domestics.
What time do you
You know, after like 11 o'clock, you're really supposed to turn it down. If you can hear it in your house and you're across the street, then it's a problem.
And the police will come out?
We'll definitely come out. Well, we respond. These are all calls that we responded on. I'm going to try to speed it up because I don't want you guys to listen.
Chief, but when you call for the disturbance, you know, you have to give your name.
You don't have to. You can be anonymous. You can say, you know what, I don't want to give my name. We're still going to send somebody.
Oh, well.
Yeah, 911. Don't call non-emergency. I don't know why this is. Okay, I got it now. Accidents. This is a problem in Weston. I will tell you, It's kind of frustrating for me because I've been trying to make a dent and reduce accidents, and year to date we have an increase from 901 to 928. We had 901 accidents last year, and now we're at 928. I really believe that distraction driving is the cause of this. You drive down, you know, today I went and got a cup of coffee. If you know where a town center is, I'm really 3 blocks from my office. Two people in front of me, one person was on the phone, they're just creeping along. They weren't paying attention to driving. They were on the phone talking, and I was getting a little frustrated. I was behind them. And, you know, I had a bunch of things going on, so I needed to get back to the station. That person got out of my way. Same thing, get out on Bonaventure. Same person, you know, another person on the cell phone. They're not paying attention. That's our big problem, I think, in Weston, probably all over the county. Worst intersection. Listen, if you want to live an extra 5 years, stay off of Royal Palm Boulevard and Weston Road. I'm being facetious, obviously. But Royal Palm and Weston Road, 65 accidents here to date. I put policemen there. 8 hours a day, the accidents still happen right in front of them. They do not pay attention. They're rear-ending, making improper turns.
Okay. Coming out of Midtown.
Yes. That is, I will tell you. I'm glad you brought that up. The county is coming in this week, and they're going to resynchronize the lights, Renee. And what's going
to?
No. But on Bonaventure, what's going to happen? It's going to cause bigger gaps for you to get out and make the left turn.
They're trying not to cut through.
Yeah. They don't want to cut through Windmill Ranch, exactly. So they're trying this for the next month and a half. Hopefully it'll work. It'll allow people to get out and make a left turn. Making a left turn is a dangerous thing to do anywhere. We got a lot of cars on the road, and obviously we got a lot of accidents. But these are the main intersections that where we have crashes. Look at that, 65. Then it drops down to 21. That's quite a bit. I'm not happy with that number.
There's a question. There's a lot of places that have laws.
Yeah, there are states. Florida's not one of them. Right here we have citations. Remember we talked about citations a couple times? We made more arrests, a lot through our traffic citations. Year to date, last year, 2013, 8,128 tickets. We're not writing those tickets to generate income. Those are violations and traffic stops. We're really trying to reduce accidents. Here we are now, 2014, 10,313 tickets, citations. This is where we're writing them. Bravo is the day shift, by the way, I'm sorry. We write most of our tickets on Bravo shift. Let's see, what's a good day not to be driving in Weston? Wednesday. So Tuesday and Wednesday, stay off the road because we're out there writing tickets. Hey. Monday's not a good day. Okay, you got a tip? I'll be right with you, girl.
I have a question. When
yes,
you go inside a gated community,
can we run radar?
Are you asked to do that by the Homeowners Association or do it on your own?
We do both. I'll be honest with you, Weston Hills Communities, gated community, we wrote 54 tickets last month in Weston Hills, and probably 24 of those were for speeding. This is Bonaventure, by the way. I'm sorry, you did ask me a question.
There's a new building you're building near the
EOC Center. That's going to be government offices, code enforcement building, and it's going to be a Cat 5 building, so it's going to be very safe. You know, listen, we got hit with a bad hurricane. You need city operations to be up and running the minute that thing passes. That's where we're going to be operating out of. So it's a Cat 5 building. It's going to be a beautiful building when it's done. They're finishing the roof this week. This is Bonaventure, and I want to kind of speed up. Actually, yeah, this is Bonaventure right here. This is the whole city. Accidents, 928. Citations, 10,313. Right here, accidents. 58 in Bonaventure, 461 citations. Lieutenant DeMarco just completed a full-week traffic operation. We wrote 64 tickets up here. So that's not counted on this number, but you can see here where these are citation spots, and these are multiple tickets. We try to write tickets where accidents are occurring, intersections. See all the intersections? People aren't stopping at stop signs, they're rolling through, they're not paying attention, they're rear-ending their cars. And that goes for the whole city here.
What about running the red lights? Like three, four cars go through after the light has turned.
That's a bad thing. You're right. Running red lights is dangerous. We're setting up. I'm going to show you something on Racket Bluff Road. Let's see if it's the next slide. This is traffic related, and the reason why I threw this on there, and I was at a meeting, and a gentleman said there were more fatalities in Weston involving cyclists than any other city in Weston, city in county. So that's definitely not true. The city of Weston had one fatality, and it was the cyclist's fault. Right here, in 2014, it occurred by Saddle Club by the West Regional Park. These are all the locations. In 2013, 10 cyclists were killed in traffic accidents. One in Deerfield, Southwest Ranches, and one in Tamara. These are the cities. In 2014, we had our accident. Tamara had an accident. These are the other cities. So, we only had one fatality in the last 2 years. I just didn't want people to be putting out, bad information. So that's why I put that out, because he mentioned it, and it kind of bothered me, and I spoke to him about it. I don't know how many people he went around telling that.
A lot.
Yeah, well, I did. This is interesting. Do you ever see those speed cards that tell you speed, and you're like, what do those things do? This is what they do for us. This is the information. You call us. Anybody in here can pick up the phone. They can call me, Carrie, Lieutenant DeMarco, say, people are speeding on Racket Club Road. I want something done about it. Say it nicer. We'll be a little bit more fine. Yeah, I'll just do it. But what we do is we put that card out there, and we look. Not all the data's here, but we try to identify when people are speeding. First of all, are they speeding? And what time of the day? Why would I want to know what time of the day they're speeding? Because if I put a deputy out there for 8 hours, I'm wasting resources. So if I notice speeding between 3:30 and 4, that's the time I have the deputy there. That thing tells me, this right here doesn't, but the other printout does. I didn't want to go through the whole printout, but this is the speed. Now it's Racket Club, right here, Racket Club Road, from 9:22. to 10:10. What is that, 18 days? Right? 18 days. How many cars do you think went through that, past that speed sign, our speed radar car? Just go in one direction, south, southbound. Right? 400. In an 18-day period, 32,878 cars. 32,000. You get a lot of cars on Racket Club. This was just north of Black by Danielle Court there, but we were getting southbound traffic. Now, right here, its posted speed is 30 plus, people going over 30 miles an hour. 14,081. Are they speeding? They could be doing 31, 32, 33. The court, they won't recognize a ticket less than like 35 or less. Can't write somebody a ticket. Now 36, 37 we can, but normally 10 miles over the limit, that's when we start. So let's go 10 miles over the limit. The speed limit is 30, 40. That's when we start writing tickets. Out of 32,878, 727 people went more than 10 miles over the limit. 50 miles, that means 20 miles over the limit, only 14 cars. Do we have a problem here? Yeah, we got some people speeding. Are we going to address it? Yes, we are. I looked at the intersection of Black Run and Racket Club in the last 3 years, we had 4 accidents there. What's the cause? They're all different directions, although I will tell you the city's looking at putting up different signage there because there are multiple lanes. So we are working with the city on that. I wanted to show this guy, because this guy, I really don't like him. His name is James Jarvis, and I can say that he's going to be 18 on November 22nd, 96. On November 22nd, he'll be 18 years old. He quit school. He was a real problem for us. He a lot of graffiti. One morning, I got a call from a city employee, well, unnamed, but all along Royal Palm, this guy went nuts, writing graffiti. And so it was a real problem. We put people out, we didn't catch anybody. 5-6 days later, does it again. So, oh man, we got a problem, you know. Here he hit us twice, and we started finding his graffiti all over the place. We had surveillance out there.
We even put cameras up.
Yeah, we put cameras. We have cameras we put to try to catch this guy or anybody breaking into cars, graffiti anywhere. So we really, this was a real big issue. I was, you know, on the hot seat when I say that. Hey, what are we doing about this guy? He's costing the city a lot of money. These signs, they have to be taken down. New signs put up, and a bunch of city signs he wrote on. So it was getting expensive. We were up over $3,000 in signs. Probably didn't see this because within an hour or two of us finding this, the city came out and repainted. So but it was a real problem. And what I like about this jerk, and I can call him a jerk, sent his ex-girlfriend a video of him with another girl by accident. Got her really upset. And guess what she did?
She ran it out.
She called us and said, I know who's doing all this. We got him. We arrested him, and he went to jail. He got out. He was on house arrest, and, you know, you think he's going to pay attention to house arrest?
No.
He took off. His dad did the right thing, called. We came to the house. We ended up grabbing him. He had narcotics on him. He's still in custody. Actually, he was just released. But he's a bad kid. He's got tattoos here. And we've had problems. Remember earlier I said we target the 20% of our population? Did you guys remember me saying that? 20% was 80% of our crime. He's one of them. We've been working him. We've arrested him several times. Anytime we get down on him, he goes to jail. Because he does stuff like this.
What's his justification to do this?
You know, it's real funny. He's got video. His girlfriend gave us the video of him spray painting. It was great evidence. Social media, these kids love to show what they do, the damage they do. They're really, I hate to say it, but they do bad things. You know, I don't want to say, I mean, he's done some really bad things, and honestly, I don't want to even get into other things he's done. That's why I can say he's a jerk, because this is just some of the stuff that he's done. He's done some real serious things that's currently under investigation.
What can we do to help with it now?
Well, when you see him, he calls. So, I think hopefully his dad will toss him out, or he'll go live with his mom in another city if ever finds. Go ahead, sir. I'm sorry.
In all this crimes, where does greed and human trafficking come in?
In the city of Weston? Does anybody think in the city of Weston we have a problem with human trafficking?
No.
Well, I'm going to tell you a little story. Did anybody read the New York Times?
Yes, I did.
Okay, good. Because last week in the New York Times, on the second page of the New York Times, there was a guy who was arrested. And this is going to answer your question. His name is Nylon. He wasn't arrested yet. You ever hear the name Nylon? Nylon worked for Homeland Security. And I could talk about this because it was in the news. He was doing an investigation involved in human trafficking. net human trafficking for prostitution. And we encountered him here in Weston, and he ended up losing his job, and it's all tied in. We had massage parlors in the city of Weston of Asian women that were brought here to do prostitution in the city of Weston, and they were prostitutes. They're living in one-room flats. They're pretty much sex slaves. Believe me, it goes on in Weston, all the good communities. It's all over Broward County. You don't really see it, but it's there. In Pompano, we had apartments where five and six women would be there, and they would do prostitution all day long. They would bring van loads of people to have sex with them. That still goes on today. If you think it's not happening here in Weston, it definitely is. I would be foolish to tell you that it's not. You know, these massage parlors where you get a massage, a lot of them are legitimate. I go for massages all the time. I've never been offered any funny business or anything, but there are out there. They were in Weston because we arrested two women, and they disappeared. We charged them, and they were gone, but they were prostitutes. And so you're right, we do have it. And the other matter, I really can't go into any further, but it was in the New York Times. Look it up. It's a very interesting reading story. Weston is right there in the middle of it. So.
Tony's boss got a job, too.
Pardon?
Tony Bosch gave us a good name.
Who?
Tony Bosch. The A-Rock, the guy who was in protecting the guy, Zero.
Yeah. That's true.
Yeah.
These are programs that we've run in Weston, the district. It's quite a bit, but Carrie, pretty much, her and Alan, I know some of you probably met Alan, great team. These are different programs in your different HOAs. You can invite us, we can do talks on, well, cyberbullying is more for kids, but grandparent scam. Renee mentioned she got a phone call, a scam. And they were threatening her. It turned out that they were calling people all over the country, and the number came originated from out of the country. There's a lot of different things that we can bring to your groups. Take a look at it. You don't have any handouts on it or anything. But, you know, any questions? Because I don't want to, you know, actually, you're very honest with me.
Look at it.
the community as an individual, I mean, it just makes me feel very, very safe to know that you guys know what you're doing.
You guys live in the safest city in the state of Florida.
What I wanted to do, just for two more minutes, I was going to bring Jim Jones up, but it'll take too much time.
Wait a minute.
Who's going to help Jim get Debbie Wasserman Schultz?
Renee.
Okay. There are potentially four or five people who want to speak to this group, which is kind of a nice problem to have. And I'm just going to ask you by a quick show of hands how much interest there is or there isn't in the following kinds of programs. And I've got a lot more detail, but Dr. Barry Friedman's an audiologist, and he wants to talk about So for all those who said what, I think that's a yes. Now, he's not selling anything. He's a professor of audiology and teaches and educates people about what the latest and greatest are in hearing and audiological things. Any interest?
No.
Raise your hand, just like.
All right, that's majority.
Okay.
Four people.
There is a woman named Gail Weisberg who runs this, the Daniel D. Cantor Senior Center in Central Hills. Those of us who were in denial, we're still seniors. We're all seniors. They're trying to expand their outreach into Weston and want to talk. And I don't think this would be an all-night kind of affair, but maybe 15, 20-minute discussion about what they're doing. Any interest in that?
No.
Okay.
Larry. Let's keep talking FBI work with the gun.
What he was asking is, do I have any interest in going back to the old format of basically open microphone and discussing what's going on in the world right now?
No.
What's on your mind? Not a presenter, but just a point of view. Anybody, what's the interest level of that?
No?
Wow. Shocking. Okay. So far we have one out of three.
Talk about a sense of attention.
Harry Rosen would like to talk about not his
Harry Rosen,
the former mayor who is now practicing law, personal injury. Brought up an interesting point to me and said he'd like to talk about this, which is the laws that are going on right now that are being changed affect you and me, us, in a way that our rights are being impacted in terms of being able to sue, how much we can sue for, that kind of thing. Any interest in that one? Okay.
Three.
Interestingly enough, okay, Harry's on. Sheila has a point of view about Harry.
No, I'm just saying.
So here we go. There were some votes here, and the vote is no. See, because I'm married almost 30 years, and I know that we're not having Harry.
We're like 31,
I'm not having Harry. Again, poor Harry. He was almost. Remember Mark Eyeglosh?
Yes.
Now, we have heard Mark twice, but his mother says he'll come back.
Right.
What do we think about having Mark?
Dorothy,
we need to talk. Finally, there's a possibility of getting Steve Goldstein and a couple other sportscasters. He's tough to get. Is there interest in having that kind of thing? He's the one.
All right. Steve Goldstein, yes.
So when I take away from this,
what is Steve Goldstein doing?
The voice of the Panthers, that you might be able to get a couple of sportscasters in we'll talk about our okay, so, excuse me, I know we've gone a long time tonight, but so I will try to get with Barry Freeman. We're going to try to get Debbie Wasserman. boss, Rich Schultz, or you're going to work with Chip Jones, I'll let you boss you. I don't know about Harry Rosen, I'll have to discuss it with the boss. And Mark Aguilar for sure. And then the next meeting, just to reiterate, December 11th is Marco Rubio's State Director of Political Affairs, who is open to anything we want to talk about. And he has a question. Anything else?